evening to all of you. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce first technical sessions faculty, Sri Abhijit Ji. He is a CA with 27 years of post-qualification experience in business, industry and practice. He is a law graduate, speaking at various ICAI WIRC seminars since last 20 years at staff training colleges also. He has conducted assignments with over 50 banks till date, and he is a contributory to guidance note on audit of banks to the institute. He is also contributory to the article on demonetization published by WIRC in December 2016. With this, I request all of you to welcome him. Here also I like to give one announcement that our IDT committee, Indirect Tax Committee, is coming with the publication of compliance in service tax in the banks within 2 or 3 days. That will be available on the IDT website. So members can take the benefit while conducting the audit. Also, as Chintan Bhai has said, that GST is coming. So our role while doing the bank audits in this year end will be how the bank branches can take transitional credit while they are transforming to GST. With this, I request Kaushal Kaparshan ji to give a bouquet and comment to our distinguished faculty. Not taking much of time, sir, no worries.
Good morning. At the outset, I would like to thank Lokesh for introducing me to Ahmedabad branch and then Ahmedabad branch officials for inviting me to address the gathering on this session, especially on the topic of demonetization. And the fact that this has been selected as the first topic, I think the chief guest already gave some introduction on this topic as being the meat starter or something, where the starters are better than maybe the lunch. Now the issue of demonetization, I would really not like to go into what demonetization was, and whether it was good or bad, whether how much of currency finally has come in or how much liability is accumulated. I think that's more of an economic perspective. I'll just focus only on the role which we as chartered accountants, either in the capacity of concurrent auditors, internal auditors, or in the capacity of a branch statutory auditor or maybe a central statutory auditor. If you strictly look at the primary focus of a statutory auditor is to give a true and fair view of the accounts, then any of the demonetization process per se will not have a direct bearing unless maybe there is a question of some page note being detected and then that amount has been booked as a loss to maybe the P&L making a day. But carrying apart any of the circulars which RBI issued and which is the duty of the bank or the branch to comply, and any of those circulars have not been complied with, then any of the comments which are made by the branch statutory or branch concurrent auditors or maybe the internal auditors of the bank, I think the stat auditor will have to take due cognizance and incorporate those comments in his LFR. So primarily it will be the reporting on the LFR which the chartered accountant would be found as a branch statutory auditor. The guidance note on audit of banks 2017 edition has been released. I think it's available on the website. I think it specifically focuses on certain issues which are to be covered by statutory auditor. So it's a guidance, so it assumes some mandatory form. So to that extent, we need to really look into those areas which have been specifically commented upon. Even if the guidance note at the time of giving, there were certain discussions whether any guidance has to be really given to the members on demonetization. And I think because of the fact that it was such a major event happening for banks in the year, and the fact that there would have been varied practices followed by various startup pension funds, I think they felt it necessary to incorporate some points in the guidance book, and I think we'll take a look at those points also. I think let me straight away come to the presentation so we would have maybe a structured way of how you look at it. I look at this from the point of view of the duties of a chartered accountant in the capacity of a concurrent auditor of the branch. I think that duties during the demonetization process, I think the demonetization process is already over. So whatever a concurrent auditor had to do, he has done. A lot of banks appointed concurrent auditors on an additional assignment with a defined scope. A lot of banks also had, apart from the concurrent auditors covering demonetization process and issues, they had their internal teams also inspecting and commenting on that. So you will have issues noted during the demonetization process by internal or concurrent auditors. And now when we are at the phase of the branch statutory audit, I think what is the role as a branch statutory auditor to look into, I think, let's cover that. When I'm looking at demonetization, I think it has impacted three things. One is it has impacted liquidity, it has impacted income, and it has impacted wealth. Now when it has impacted liquidity, there has been an impact on sales. Maybe that will, that impact may continue till maybe this quarter end, or maybe in some cases that impact because of the remonetization which will be complete by, in case of saving bank account, 13th March is the date when you can, there are no limits on that also. The remonetization will be complete. I think the impact on sales will slowly trickle down. There was an impact on the cash flows, maybe to stabilize, the cash flows already have stabilized, or maybe it may trickle down in some aspect to the next quarter. But the most significant impact it would have is on the impact it will have on wealth. Now when I'm talking of wealth, I'm talking of the collateral value of securities which are pledged to the bank. And that is where a chartered accountant or a statutory auditor will come into play. I think Dhananjay would cover that in his topic on IRAC norms, but just a brief flavor. In case of doubtful assets, if you have an unsecured portion, then the provision has to be made at 100%. And a lot of industry of a lot of advances, the collateral is the main security which is valued, and on the basis of the value of the collateral, we will determine the extent of provision. So here you have a case where, because of demonetization, the property prices have fallen down, or maybe at the prices at which they are quoting, there are no buyers for the property. So if you take a lot of cooperative banks whose main recoveries at the year end are in forms of options which they conduct and the sales value which they get as a result of the sales they make of the property, I think that has been a big hit. If I generally compare the success rate of options, last year the success rate was about 25%. This year the success rate at options is even lesser, and I believe it's close to about 10%. Last year when the options were taking place, most of the options were happening at realizable value, and a significant option were also held at distressed value. In the current year, a lot of options are being conducted at distressed value, and some options are also conducted at below distressed value. So the prices which the banks are realizing on sale of collateral is clearly going down. When you look at it, my RBI circular only requires me to have a valuation once in 3 years. So if I have any valuation which is dated April 2014 and after, technically as per the letter of the law I can consider it for valuation for purposes of provisioning as of 31st March 2017. But the real valuation would actually have gone down. Now banks have a fair market value concept, they also have a realizable value, they have a business value, but generally they would value it at FMV. The actual price, the realistic price, that means the prices at which the properties could be sold could be very close to distance. So maybe that needs a significant markdown on the collateral value. The second part, I think, just doesn't cover demonetization per se, but a visit to the borrower's place. If I think the earlier chief guest made a comment that this is something which is a rare event or something which the statutory auditor should ideally not go unless very exceptional, I think I would not agree with it. It's because the role of a statutory auditor is unlimited. His role is to give whether the account gave a true and fair view. And technically, when your account gave a true and fair view, it's the account is of the balance sheet and then the P&L. And when you are talking of a P&L, it's the profit or loss for the year. And the existence of a security, the existence or the non-existence determines the provisioning. The extent of the provisioning will have an impact on the P&L. And based on the P&L, I think the account we clearly give a point value. So if you serious, I don't think the audit is restricted only to the audit at the bank premises. I think you're free to go anywhere. Maybe the only practical issue is the paucity of time. I think because of paucity of time, you may not be in a position to go and really inspect security if you want to. But I think there's no restriction in scope. So I think that's something which can be only might maybe. So that's one part, the impact on demonetization, which will clearly affect my one will be clearly the collateral. Second is the circular which has been issued on demonetization. There's a circular dated November 28th and there's a circular dated December 21st. These circulars have an effect of extending or deferring the date of classification of accounts less than 1 crore in certain cases, standard accounts only. So the date of account to be classified as an NP on November and December, the installment is deferred by 60 days and the December 28th circular extended it by further 30 days. So if an installment which falls due on November, technically now will fall due on February 10th. And its installment which falls due on December, technically falls due on March 30th because they have given a 90-day concept. But as of March 31st, both these installments are overdue. And if more than 3 installments are overdue, I think the account is an empty. So, these circulars will only have an impact of deferment of an NPA for the month of December. I think, and if there is a clear-cut RBI circular which says that if an account is an NPA at a particular date and if it is upgraded subsequently, then all overdue have to be cleared. So, if an account was an NPA in December and it was upgraded in March, then all overdue even up to February had to be cleared if this account was to be upgraded as standard. So, since there is a deferment, I think such categories will be out of NPAs for December and maybe they will get a relaxation of only for the upgradation point. The other point which I want to make is because this is also a cooperative bank seminar, there is a difference in the circular which RBI has issued or statutory audits of nationalized banks, scheduled commercial banks and cooperative. So for if the upgradation circular does not apply. The NPA circular is silent on upgradation. So if you have a case where an account was in NPA in December and if it was upgraded in March, by not recovering Jan and Feb installments, the account would have been in NPA in any scheduled commercial bank. Such circular of upgrade is just not there in any cooperative bank circular. So bank, cooperative banks are taking the leeway of the absence of a circular and not classifying those accounts as an NPA. Now there is some confusion there because some cooperative banks are being slightly conservative and adopting the circular which is given by national banks. Some cooperative banks are not doing it. I think as long as the RBI has not come out with a definite circular on that, and it's very clear that partial upgrades are allowed for cooperative banks, I think shadow accountants are following what RBI has told. So there would be a confusion. And then they would just take up this point further. So the two major impacts on demonetization which will impact your P&L balance sheet, one would be on the collateral value. The collateral value which I would then subsequently take for calculation of my provisioning in case of doubtful accounts if I intend to basically lower down or mark down the collateral value. The second will be the two circulars which are issued by RBI on November 21st and December 28th. It has an impact of deferring the classification of an NPA as of 31st December. The third point which would already have been covered but which will impact the P&L is if there have been any fake notes which have been received and as a result of those fake notes the bank would have made provisionings. There is a cash loss to that extent. So to that extent, it will impact the P&L. The rest, it's purely an issue which has to be looked into and commented in the LFR. Now the guidance note on audit of banks, it talks of demonetization at various places. The first place where it has talked about it is in the chapter on initial considerations. So what the guidance note 2017 specifically states is that in the initial representation to the branch management, which is in the form of when you obtain an MRL, it specifically states that you write to the bank management to give you details of any adverse findings which have been noted during the demonetization process, either in the course of their audit or maybe by the component of the internal audit. So what they have given as a guidance is that you incorporate in the MRL the fact that whether you have received any adverse findings on the audits related to the demonetization process during the specified period. So that's the first part where it's stated. The second part where it has stated is on the assessment of risks and controls. The guidance note clearly views demonetization process as an area where there is a risk, then there would be a regulatory non-compliance. The regulatory non-compliance would be in terms of various circulars with the RBI issued. I think RBI was issuing one circular after the other. I think there were 43 circulars which have been issued. I think I was specifically told to make a glossary of those circulars. So I have in my Word document made a glossary of all those circulars which have been there with a small gist of what that circulars contain. But the compliance of those circulars was probably a nightmare. I think one of the circulars stated that the branch had to preserve CCTV recordings. Now, if you are talking specifically for cooperative banks, I think most of the cooperative banks didn't have the facility of a CCTV recording at many of its branches. at various branches, they had a facility where the recording was happening only for 30 days. And then every after 30 days, the earlier recording used to get deleted and it used to be overwritten by a subsequent recording. Now, cooperative banks failed to detect that. Maybe their internal inspecting team or maybe the consumer auditors would also have not pointed it out at that point of time. So that would be one lacuna which you would find. And I think that would be one, if it's not coming out in any of those reports, I think it would have to come in our report as a branch record audit. Now when I sign off my branch territory audit, in my main audit report I clearly state that I have conducted the audit in accordance with the standard of audit. I mean, I clearly just state that it's conducted in accordance with the standards of auditing. What the standards of auditing really are, everybody knows, but I don't think anybody has gone really into depth and seen what the standards of auditing actually state. So as far as demonetization is concerned, I would be clearly governed by SA 600, which talks of using the work of another auditor. Or maybe SA 610, which states, or gives guidance on using the work of an other auditor or an expert. In both of these standards of auditing, it clearly states that if you are relying on the work of another auditor, then you clearly have to perform audit procedures to be satisfied about the adequacy of the work which is done by those auditors. It also says that you can liaison and interact with those auditors. And the liaisoning has to be in context with how you intend to use the reports of the other auditors. In this case, when we are referring to the demonetization process in the long form audit report, I think we clearly were not there at the time when this happened. Our appointment has not happened even as of date, but I really don't know which branches I would get for audit. But a lot of times in my LFR, I have to state on findings which are for the entire year. And I am there at the bank premises only for a certain part of the year. I think as the max, as I always say, we are clear 320 max. I am there for the last 10 days of the year. I am there for the next 10 days of the year. So I just have a 20 day max. And that also, if the appointment is big, then maybe it's like a real 30 320 where I am maybe about 10 hours or 15 hours. So it's the time gap is only about 10 days or 15 days. The significant point is in that 20 days or the 10 days of the previous year, I have to comment on some points in the LFR which are in terms of specific questions for the full year. Now I just cannot do that without relying on the words of either the concurrent or the internal auditors or relying on the representations which are given by the management. If I am relying on the representations which are given by the management, at many point of time I issue them a representation letter with various issues which I want them to address, and as is common practice, I think in most of the cases I don't get any representation from the management. So I issued an MRF, but I have not got anything in reply. Or in some cases I have just got a reply which it clearly looks that there has been no application of mine by the banker, but he has just stated that everything is in order. My essay on written representation, essay 580, clearly states that if I receive such representations, I need not accept it nicely, but I need to do other corroborative checks to ensure that this representation is in order. So whatever representations you get on demonetization, I think you clearly have to factor in essay 580, essay 600 and essay 610. And I think in your LPR, you clearly have to bring it out because you were just not there at the point of time when this demonetization process happened. You would clearly be relying on one, whatever reports which are issued by these auditors, you would have to basically test the adequacy of the scope. You would have to test basically how this audit was actually carried out. Maybe in case of current auditors, you would be in a position to liaison with them and get to know actually what they did. It may not be practically possible to liaison with the internal audit team of the bank which is to audit, but those reports will actually be there. So you have to factually state the position giving reference to what you have actually relied upon and seeing SFIP 600 and 610. Now the third point where the guidance group talks about is on the main LFAR when it talks of cash. So the first question in cash was whether the branch carries cash, sufficient cash which is within the retention limits. Now as the result of the demonetization process, I think the first few days were dirty and a lot of cash which was SBNs were deposited in the bank branches. So your retention limit would have nearly gone for a toss. So the first point maybe of rewarding the LFAR is that the retention limits have clearly been fixed. Now they would have clearly been reached in front of the branches of the bank. But in case of a branch, if the retention limits have been reached, then that's the factual statement which you have to make. The second point will come on insurance, on the adequacy of insurance. Now again, the insurance is not done at the branch level, the insurance will be done at the actual level, but whether the head office has adequately taken care to ensure the excess cash. The third would be cash in transit. This cash which was collected was at times then deposited with maybe the cooperative bank used to deposit it with State Bank of India or their accounts with ICICI or HDFC or wherever they used to have accounts. Or maybe they used to send it to the Reserve Bank of India. A lot of banks, especially the PSUs and the private banks, would have cash handling procedures. They would have contracted with various organizations like maybe would be carrying the cash on their behalf all over. But you will still get a lot of cooperative banks who would have taken their cancers without any security. So that would be one point which you need as branch statutory audit address on the cash in transit which happened at that point of time. The fourth point is the joint custody of cash. So there is a direct question in the LFAR whether the cash was in effective joint custody of two or more officials. Therefore, the procedure which is laid out by the controlling authorities of the bank. Now, what is the controlling authority in case of a branch? Now, the controlling authority would primarily mean an authority which has the ability to control or maybe govern or administer or direct the affairs or activities of the bank. So, here you have a regional office which could be a controlling authority. You would have a zonal office which could be a controlling authority, or you may even have a head office which is a controlling authority. So what exactly are the guidances and the instructions of the circulars which are being funded? The other point is you will have a lot of circulars which will be given by RBI which will be in public domain. But what the banks were doing is the banks were also in interpreting the RBI circulars and issuing circulars of their own. So apart from 40 circulars of RBI, you will have another 40 circulars of the bank which will be there. Now, the first point is the circulars which are issued by the bank have to be in sync with RBI circulars. If RBI circulars has given a very broad parameter, within that parameter, the bank circular will actually tell you how the procedure or how the activity or the sub-activity has to be done. So when you are referring to the demonetization process, it's not just the circular which are issued by RBI which would be relevant, it would be also the internal circulars which are issued by the bank from maybe HO or maybe the audit department. And based on this circular, you would have an audit which would have been done by maybe the concurrent auditors or. Now you have a situation that there may be audits which would be done by concurrent auditor. So you have to basically take the concurrent auditor's report, have a look at what the adverse findings are, have a look at that coverage. If any coverage has been missed out, whether it's possible at a very macro level for you to try to cover that. If it's not possible for you to cover that, then maybe you could just make a statement in any other point which you would like to refer or bring to the attention of the central statutory auditor or the management of the bank is that this point has not been vetted at all. The other case would be where there could be no audits conducted at all. So that the branch may not be under the scope of a concurrent audit and the branch may also not have been inspected by an internal inspection team. I think if you are unfortunate to get such a branch, then I think you are working in business. But at lots of times we just rely on, we just cut copy paste on what are the adverse findings of such auditors and we just put it without even knowing what is SA580, SA600, 690. But still we just at least put something on record. Now in a case where the branch has not been audited, then you really have to do some work, then maybe the gist has, maybe let's go to the actual presentation of what we need to do. So that's where you have to actually see what the branch has done to ensure that this process has not been missing. So these are the three areas where guidance code has talked about. So one is on the initial consideration that they come that you issue an MIR. The second is you assess the risk, which I'll talk about in detail. So assess the risk of demonetization process, mainly there will be a regulatory risk. And the third would be an actual LFR where there are specific questions. So in the fourth question that is related to cash, that you specifically address that. And if there are any other issues, then you address it in any other matters you would like to bring to the attention of the central statutory auditor or the bank manager. Now when I talk of demonetization, I firstly think that this was a big event. But I also view it in terms of risk. Risk, as I define in any activity, which threatens or will derail the achievement of the objectives of a bank. Now during the demonetization process, in the initial days, I think there was absolute lack of clarity. The absolute lack of clarity on first of the exchange itself. So whether the exchange was a daily limit, or whether the exchange was a one-time limit, or whether the exchange was a branch limit for the day, well, none of the banks had a clarity. In fact, none of the banks, or most of the banks, or some banks, had the ability to even monitor whether a person had exchanged his cash at one branch and then stood in the line in another branch and collected cash. So, if somebody has collected, withdrawn cash from a Punjab National Bank and then gone in a Union Bank of India and then to HDFC and withdrawn cash from his account there, I think there is no control. There is no exchange of information between banks. But if it came to banks itself, some of the private banks and a lot of PSU banks had that control, but still a lot of cooperative banks didn't have that control. So you had a case where somebody would withdraw from maybe a Saraswat bank at the next branch and maybe there was no control, he could withdraw money at the Y branch. And on day one, I really don't think the bank had those controls. Slowly over periods of time, they established control. When you went to a lot of branches on that day, you had bundles of 4,000 which were ready. Cash was not accepted only at the cash counter, where actually for a cash counter you had a dual lakh, you had a CCTV camera over the cash, but they were dispensed at least 3 to 4 pounds. So cash was clearly not in effective joint custody. So I think that point of in the LFR which is there, which will clearly stand. Now your issue will be that if you were not there at the branch at that point of time, and there was no audit which was done, and if you have issued an MRL, and on that MRL you have not got a response, then how do you report it? I mean, you have no choice but to give a disclaimer. I think in that aspect, I think one needs to be absolutely clear and very firm that if you are not in a position to check something, please don't rely on oral inquiry and on oral submissions which are made by the branch management and put something in the agenda. If you have got a written submission, then please state so that you are referring to a particular question and reverting based on the written submission made. But you will still have no ways to corroborate that unless you have the CCTV recording, then you have verified that. And if the CCTV recordings are not there, then there is no way you can verify and refer to some question that you have to answer. So it's better to give a disclaimer. The point is of the risk. How many of you, or how many in the banks, were aware that such an event would happen? I really don't think anybody was prepared. But anybody had anticipated that such an event would take place. So we clearly are talking of something which is an risk where the probability of occurrence is not even low, the probability of occurrence becomes even remote. But the impact is not just high, the impact is big. And that classified as a very high risk. And when you are not in a position to be prepared proactively to address such risks, I think the only thing you can do is, I think you've got to be nimble, swift-footed, agile, and adapt to whatever changes are taking place as fast as you can. So I think in this context, demonetization has to be looked at a regulatory risk event. I think what maybe somebody calls it a black swan event. I think where you are clearly not in a position to anticipate the risk and then act on it. So one of the clear failures was the one, the ability of RBI to print new notes quickly, so the demonetization had a time gap. The second was the ability of the banks to calibrate their ATMs to dispense the cash. So both this, the event happened. Then the post-implementation, how you adapt and quickly make the changes. So maybe it took the banks close to some banks, maybe 15 days or some banks, maybe the end of November. Or maybe for some banks, you know, continued till maybe December 15. Maybe now it's stabilized. But it took a lot of banks to adapt. So this is something of a regulatory risk or a black swan event, which I believe in future will only increase. And such events where one may not be in a position to actually anticipate. So what one needs to do is only respond to such situations as and when they come. Now RBI, when it comes to audit a bank, in its section 35 inspection which it does towards the year, the focus is on three things. The focus is on the NPA, the divergence, of which you already have a huge impact maybe in the last year because of the exercise which RBI did and others, there was a lot of NPAs. The second focus of the RBI as of date will be on KYC AML. And that is one area which is clearly neglected by audit. I think even if you look in a lot of bank audit seminars also which are conducted, I think the focus is on advancements and NPA. We have full sessions which are devoted to, so if you have an entire day, you have 50% of those which are devoted to advances and NPA. If you have half a day session, you will have three sessions, two sessions will be on advances and NPA and all the parts of the LFR which are related to advances. I mean, even if you look at the LFER, the questioning, the part of advances occupy 40%. So the stress on advances is very high, but in the recent years, the stress on KYC AML has increased. And I think the demonetization process only strengthens the fact that the intent of the government and of the RBI is also to move and curb this money laundering menace. So I think there is a clear shift which is evident. And as a result, I think whatever comments we are making on demonetization process assume significance because RBI is clearly expected to look into this process how it was handled by banks. And let's say if you have a situation where you find that certain banks were LPTI, I think you are hearing the people, I think just as recent as yesterday, there's something with some DGA or some AGA or some branch head of some branches that may be arrested on charges of maybe making some special favors or transferring cash directly from the currency desk to certain account holders. So where such issues are noted, and maybe if they are noted at maybe the branch where you were possibly a branch statutory auditor and you have not made any comments on that, maybe there could possibly be some questions. So it's better to be safe and look into the process and address it. So with clearly the regulatory shift and the government shift in terms of their focus towards anti-money laundering, I think a look into this demonetization process assumes basic. Again, what we are talking of is what does the RBI specifically state? The RBI in its FAQs, which are updated as of February 17, which is officially put up in their website, it states that the demonetization process was done by the government to curb the menace of counterfeit notes and blackmail. So they are clearly emphasizing that the question of black money, unaccounted money, and when you are talking of black or unaccounted money, you are clearly talking of a money laundering or tax evasion. So that is where your entire misuse of the process during demonetization will exist. Reports or actual factual statements where SSEs who have deposited over a specific amount in their current accounts or who have deposited over a specific amount in their savings bank accounts have received notices from the department or their names have been published on the official income tax website. And there are reports that about 18 lakh SSEs have been sent notices. But I have known of clients or I have known of people who have received notices where they have to respond in a particular manner to what was the source of deposit. So whether it is of your own cash balance or whether it is out of your savings, and then you state. So that's one part that somebody has received a notice from the tax department where it's technically got a branch auditor, statutory auditor. The point is that each branch or a bank has to file something which is known as a suspicious transaction report with the FIR. The suspicious transaction report has to be filed within 7 days of knowing whether the transaction was suspicious or not. Now, what is a suspicious transaction? The KYC AML Master Circular dated February 2016 clearly defines what a suspicious transaction is. Now, they have stated that a suspicious transaction is something which does not have any bona fide value or an economic rationale, or maybe something which is of unusual complexity, and something which arouses suspicion. Okay, there are other ways that it could be related to terrorism activity. So if it belongs to any organization, then the error is placed, then maybe they have to be reported. But if any transaction will defy economic rationale, I think has to be reported as such. Now, how many suspicious transactions have transactions reported in this field? I think one of the duties of the branch statutory auditor would clearly be to look into how this suspicious transaction process was handled. Now, if you have cash deposits over, let's say, a threshold, let's say the threshold was, if the threshold was 12.5, then let's say if you have deposits over that threshold, then whether such transactions could be termed as suspicious, which would need a filing to the FIU. Now the KYC AML guidelines clearly states that if the branch has a reason to doubt, then it should file an STR. Otherwise, the branch should have sufficient grounds or sufficient documents or sufficient evidences on record in case somebody questions it to be enabled to satisfy the regulator or maybe the auditor that this transaction was not suspicious. And many a time, branches do not get adequate information from the borrower and they feel shy of reporting the transaction as STR. So I think one of the clear focus of a central statutory auditor or a branch statutory auditor would be to see the STR filing process. Each branch has a mechanism of finding alerts. These alerts are based on certain parameters based on transactions which are identified. Such transactions need not be by cash, it can be by check also. But post this demonetization, there will be a huge surplus of cash which would have been there. So whether these transactions really qualify as a suspicious transaction is something which the branch will have to find, but the auditor will clearly have to look at the process. And if we find there is deficiency in the process or we feel certain transactions are suspicious but have not been filed, and in other aspect that the income tax department sends them notices or not, or what action it takes against them, but as the branch statutory auditor, when you talk about demonetizing process, you cannot delink the STR filing process from that. So the basic principle would be there would be a parameters on which alerts would be generated. Based on these alerts, either at the central office, then the each branch has a branch as a principal officer who is nominated to supervise this KYC AML process and the filing of STRs. This principal officer has to ensure that this process is working effectively. So whether the branch has complied with this process and filed STR in case of transactions which appear suspicious, I think that would be one duty. I think keep that just in mind because this would be a very significant part. There are a lot of cases where you, on one side you have a notice from a department saying to explain the source of a transaction. Maybe that transaction would be modified. But I can draw a parallel thing. And if there are so many transactions on which SECs have been sent notices and you just don't have a fraction of these being filed as STRs, then sometimes the STR process is not. Now there could be other ingenious ways of maybe how you could have circumvented this process. So you hear a lot of reports about various dummy accounts being opened. You hear various reports about some shell companies being used where cash was deposited and then maybe it was transferred to some other account, and it's a typical anti-money laundering process of first placement, then layering, and then integration. Then please read that circular on AML which talks of placement, layering, and integration. So placement is the initial stage when the money is introduced into the banking system. Second is the layering part where it gets collected and then transferred to one main account. and then from which it becomes a part of an official transaction and it gets integrated with the entire economy. So that's three parts of the money laundering process, is the placement, layering and integration. So there are various such cases where maybe the account holder would never have deposited any cash in his entire lifetime, and suddenly he would have come and deposited cash. This is our view, my personal view, and this is what I stand, I have taken as a transparent audit. So till the limits which are officially allowed by RBI, about 2.5 lakhs in savings bank account, and let's say 12.5 lakhs in current account if cash was deposited, I think we never looked into that. But for all deposits which were made over that amount, we clearly looked into the fact whether these transactions were bona fide and these transactions were matching with the income profile of the client or the customer of the bank as is known to the branch. And if we found that certain cash deposit just didn't match the profile, we asked them to file an STR with the FI. And I've seen two cases of banks, as usual. So you will have one of the two extremes, one which have very trigger happy in filing an STR. So the moment you had cash deposits in savings account over 2.5 lakhs and over 12.5 lakhs without verification, they file an STR with the FI. Some banks have not filed STR at all. There are some banks who have actually examined it, where they found it to be suspicious, and on a case-to-case basis with adequate documentation, they filed the STRs. This is something, I think as large statutory auditors, we'll have to quickly take an overview of this process, so that's where there will be an increase in our scope of work. And if it takes an extra day to do it, I think we'll do it. The KYC AML circular requires each bank to classify its borrowers according to their risk profiles. So you have a borrower classification as high risk, medium risk and a low risk. Now these classifications has to be periodically reviewed as per the KYC AML guidelines. So ideally a branch is supposed to know which customers are in the high risk profile. If the customers are in the high risk profile, then the guideline expects us to enhance due diligence. Now whether such an enhanced due diligence has been done by the bank or the bank. And if an STR is filed in any particular account, then if the account is either in the low risk or the medium risk profile, it immediately has to move to a high risk profile. Whether that is done. So this would be some parts of the AML guidelines which would be applicable maybe to the demonetization process, because there was a huge surplus of cash which is coming to the system. Now these would be rare occasions. I'm just giving this because there is a theoretical discussion and because of the fact that this could happen. I really don't know, I have not come across cases where this has happened. What is the extent of fake notes which have actually been caught? So for handling counterfeit currency or handling fake currency, there is a clear-cut procedure which has been laid down by RBI. Now when RBI comes for its annual inspection of branches, especially in cooperative banks, it visits some branches. And what RBI specifically does is, it interacts with the frontline officials of the bank, the front office guys who are customer facing and who are dealing with cash and who will be encountering or will be privy to this fact that a money laundering can be done or be in a position to prevent it. So the RBI circular clearly states that such staff needs to be trained. So RBI really goes and checks whether these guys are really aware of the circular. So it blatantly asks them questions. And it clearly finds out that these guys are not trained. And you will find RBI clearly mentioning in its section 35 report that the branch officials are not aware of KYC AML procedures and they need training. And earlier this used to be RBI used to, in its inspection report, used to classify an action as a part of a bank as minor and major. Now this is coming as a major action. So it's a serious item. So if it's a serious item, it needs immediate response. So your KYC AML is a direct follow-up, and suddenly your regulatory risk or your money laundering risk is immediately on an equal footing as your credit. Now your risk-based internal audit of banks or risk-based audit says that you allocate your time in accordance with the risk. So maybe I think this year, because of the demonetization process, there needs to be a clear shift when the percentage of time you need to devote to verification of the KYC AML needs to be clearly increased. So you had some ingenious ways of some clients exchanging cash at the energy counter. You had cases where then clients or customers used to look into each and every family member who has a bank account and used to deposit less than 2.5 lakhs in his account, believing that this was a blanket permission that you deposited. I still feel not happy, but I think then there will be so many STRs which would be filed. But you have people who have practically never even had a rupee transaction, had suddenly some cash in their account. Then you had somebody who followed some ingenious ways of taking out demand drafts or pay orders in cash, and then after some point of time cancelling them, and then either getting new currencies, or maybe they make it till December 30th, and anyway they would get new currency. Then there were cases which I've heard, I'm not seeing myself, where cash, instead of being parked in a deposit account, was parked in a suspense account. And from the suspense account, maybe it was then transferred to the customer account maybe after the period of time. So generally the auditors would only look at this suspense account as a position at the start of the month and the end of the month. They will generally not see the later extract. A branch auditor. Due to paucity of time. And maybe a competent auditor would not. Doesn't know the process. So such transactions could get skipped where something has been really misused, where instead of crediting the account, where cash has been deposited, you have passed it in some sundries or suspense account or some sundry creditors account. You have cases where this was done either with collusion, in which case I think there will be one more question comes into the mind whether this requires reporting as a fraud. Because RBI definition of fraud clearly states that the various transactions which should be classified under fraud, and then it is over any other area. So any other area where, let's say, you take with the intent or the mens rea part, or there is an intent to benefit somebody at the expense of another, and it would broadly be classified under fraud. So whether banks or branches have made any fraud reporting as a result of the demonetizing process. I don't think any branch or bank has even taken the call to classify something as a fraud. Now you get reports in the papers of people being caught, or people misusing or abusing the system. And if you can get a criminal complaint filed or they can be arrested, then technically this has to be a fraud. So I think if there are any cases which qualifies frauds, I think one of the duties of the RBI master circular on frauds is that if an auditor comes to know about the fraud, then if that amount is over a particular threshold, then he has to directly report it. But if you find no such cases below the threshold, I think you could draw it to the attention of the central statutory auditors that a reporting under fraud or such cases could also be looked at whether a reporting under fraud would be necessary. And when one talks of fraud, I think one part which comes synonymous with that is staff accountability. So is staff accountability fixed? Or has someone considered the staff accountability? Now there are some other genuine cases where customers have gone wrongly given a wrong account number. And when they have not given the correct account number at the time of deposit, the balance will not be credited to a certain account. default will show your standard default. So you have accounts which will be transferred directly to a central deposit. And maybe he turn up on the third day or the fourth day and say this was the case, there is no credit in the account and he will give the correct account. Then maybe if the transfer has happened by way of a KB to his account, and if the CPR or the reporting system of the bank will pick this up. So if the system of a bank to report to RBI cases of such deposits or such transactions in the CPR, or maybe as per the requirement of section, the new section which has come for reporting, if it is linked only to current savings accounts and not to such other accounts, then maybe it could escape reporting. So please have a look whether this can happen. I am not seeing such entries happening. But this is more to do with the configuration also of the CPR report to all deposits over that amount, or whether it's only configured to savings and current account. So in a broad nutshell, I think this is what is expected of the auditor as a result of this demonetization. What I do is I quickly go to the specific duties as an auditor. I think the tone of it at the top is very clearly evident. So one is, as a concurrent or the internal auditor, whether there was a tone at the top that the banks were really serious about ensuring that this person was not missing. Then, based on RBI circulars, a lot of banks issued clarifications. So I think based on the clarifications which were issued, you would also know whether the bank was whether serious in clarifying what RBI had communicated. Because each and every officer of the bank at the remote level would not be in touch with what RBI had. A lot of banks had given additional assignments to auditors at a certain fee. Certain banks I know even gave assignments where they asked auditors to go as decoy customers. So there were some questions which were given to auditors where they were said, you go to the branch posing that you have huge amounts of cash and you want to exchange, and whether this can be possible, whether some commission is can be taken on this or whatever. So they wanted to do some mystery shopping. So some banks had done that. And they also wanted specific reports. I really don't know how effective it was, because by that at all points of time the banks were aware that somebody of an auditor would come and ask this question, so they were pretty careful on whom they were dealing with. But banks had this policy of even having surprise claims. A lot of this would depend on data analytics. So for you to analyze data, something like what was the cash received in the account from 1st April to 7th November or 8th November or 9th was a holiday from 1st to 9th of November. And that was what was the cash received subsequently. If there is no correlation between that and bank analyzed such data, or bank was just going by the CPR or maybe the limits. So what was the analytics which the bank really did to ensure that the system was not misused? I think the RBI clearly had an expectation to ensure that the system was not misused to launder money. I think that was a clear-cut regulatory expectation. And I think the regulatory expectation gets translated into the rules and duties of an auditor is to ensure that the system has not been misused, and whatever other circulars which have been issued by RBI have been taken care of. So I would say auditors don't really demonetize that there is no violation of RBI internal circular. One, whether there was clarity on interpretation of RBI circular. There was no money laundering. There was no misuse of the exchange process. I think exchange process was clearly misused. What were the records which were kept for noting the exchange process? Whether there was any preference given to select customers? Whether there was receipt of fake notes, how were the fake notes handled? I think RBI has a very clear cut policy on how to handle fake notes, and a lot of banks and a lot of branches are just not following the policy. I think the policy clearly states that you need to inform those notes and file an FIR. I think a lot of times if they find a fake note, they just cancel it and make some cancellations and hand it over back to the customer because they don't want to go through the lengthy cumbersome process. I think this is a clear misuse of that. At times they have just even given the currency back without even cancellation so that it can be used again. And maybe some bank may accidentally take it. Now banks have RBI clearly stated to banks that you use various instruments like your fake note detection machine, you use UV lamp. But I don't think a lot of banks would be even equipped with that, especially cooperative banks. Small branches of cooperative banks or DCCP, it would just not be
operated. Even in nationalized banks also there are no.
So I'm saying nationalized banks there would be some, but in cooperative banks, a lot of cooperative banks would not have that. Now, when we are talking of a cooperative banks scenario, the scenario in the district central cooperative banks is, I think, even beyond repair. A lot of district central cooperative banks have NPAs, gross NPAs as high as 25-30% up. Their net NPAs are 15% to 20% up. And RBI clearly talks of a good bank as somebody with gross NPAs less than 7% and net NPAs below 3%. So when you have something with gross NPAs over 25% or net NPAs over 20%, then clearly the health of the bank will be maintained. And DCCP post 24th November were not even allowed to accept cash. So a lot of SBNs are still lying with DCCP. The RBI has not even collected it. So I really don't know what would be the status unless RBI comes out with a circular post. If anybody is an auditor of a DCCP, and he has an additional duty as a central statutory auditor or maybe as a branch auditor, because the branches are saddled with a lot of SBNs still. RBI has not collected yet from them. Ahmedabad has inspected to DCCP. They want to have a second round of inspection. But as of date, it is only DCCP that the cash is still lying. Now, one is written conditions of retention level and insurance coverage. Security arrangement of branch and cash in transit. Any violation of internal control or custody. I think point number 6, 7, 8, 9, or maybe even in 5, or maybe even in 4, or maybe even in point number 3, you will have it. So if you want a checklist, I think this one major could be a good checklist. What you need to check in the new monitoring. One is adherence to branch standing, I think this clearly went for a talk. So I really don't know whether branches are supposed to adhere to a timing and if there is a change in timing whether they should implement RBI or whether it's a violation of the stop and establish the branch or the inspect. But branch timing is clearly not being. There was clearly a lack of availability of due loans for dispensation, so a customer had money in his account but he still could not withdraw. So you will have a lot of customer delinquencies and complaints as a result. So how are they addressed by the bank? So if there are any complaints, there are two types of complaints. There will be complaints made at the branch level, there will be complaints made to the banking ombudsman. So please see whether there are any complaints at the banking ombudsman level which pertain to this branch which you are auditing. That data would be available from the branch or it would be available from the bank. If you have not got the data, please state so very clearly in the LFR that you don't want to use the data, so you cannot comment. Filing of STR, CTR, which is of primary importance, which I have talked for a detailed length of time, I think this has two key significance. And one of the key checking points of the demonetization process is whether there was an increase in STR. And in one line, actually, I was surprised that the CTR had actually fallen. Now, CTR is something if a cash deposit at one point of time is more than 10 lakhs, then the bank automatically files the CTR with the FID. And it was surprising, I expected the CTR to actually rise, but the CTR had drastically fallen. So that means that earlier a person was depositing cash, it was just because he was not careful. I think during the demonetization process, there was extreme planning while depositing. So each point took care that it didn't deposit 10 lakhs at one point of time, so it broke it up. or he found various people, or the concept, I think RBI had one circular on money views, and then the circular on beneficial ownership. I think we a lot of, I think there was a report that in Calcutta, a lot of Jandan account were closed of 15-20 crore. I think one of the key, then submission of timely and accurate information to the regulator. I think one branch here, one bank clearly came into trouble because it accidentally filed some wrong information. It was some error. And because of that, I think the regulator got in something that some huge violations were being done and before that an inspection. And then suddenly rumors flew that there is a bank that done some money laundering process in that situation. So there's a reputation risk involved also here. Now maybe it has subsided, but at that point of time it was there. KYC compliance again. A lot of accounts were not KYC compliant. RBI circular clearly stated that to collect cash only if the account were KYC compliant. So when the customer came in to deposit cash, the bank found that his account was not KYC compliant. Therefore, a lot of time spent on actually ensuring the compliance. One of the big issues which could happen is the dormant accounts. A lot of dormant accounts which were never operative suddenly became operative. So now if branch has any analytics or bank has any analytics of, let's say, from 1st April to November 8, how many accounts which were dormant became operative, and in the demonetization process, if any accounts suddenly became operative, I think maybe you could comment on that. If there is no analytics, I think you can just say that branch has no analytics. And you can't comment because the information is not available. But please have a look at how many dormant accounts became operative, because this could be one case where such accounts could be misused. You must be having a lot of ATM downtime. Whenever I used to go to withdraw money from any ATM, I would find the ATM completely down. So now if you have each bank monitors the downtimes of ATM, and that downtime of ATM is in a fraction of 0.01% or something. So you will have ATM which will be down for very significantly less time. I think for the entire month of November, maybe from November 10 to 30th, you could have ATM, it could be down as much as 50%. Now I would see even ATMs of Citibank and HDFC being down. They just shut. For days they were shut. Locker operation. And suddenly a lot of locker operations had stopped. I really don't know whether banks have monitored or not.
Thank you. expenditure checks are carried out either through internal or team or external concurrent internal auditor, and steps are taken to address adverse issues noted by the process correction as per the matter. Now that's my duty as a section statutory auditor. Regulatory expectation is sometimes the spirit and the letter of law of the circular. There is no issue of process to facilitate money laundering. Submission of information is asked for by the registrar has been filed in time and is accurate. Filing of STR, CTRs. Any adverse issues noted are addressed effectively. Appropriate action has been taken against staff of NGO auditing circular and affecting money laundering of sending customers in cash exchange or
I think that's clearly the regulator expectation. However, the regulator expectation that if this has to be clearly factored into the
Olive is not coming.
RBI expectation is that the branch should take action against staff which has been found guilty of violating instructions or circulars which have been issued by the bank and the RBI. Especially relating to affecting the money launderers or maybe favoring any customers in cash exchange or dispensation. This is clearly a regulatory expectation. And if this is done, I think somewhere it has to find its mention in the scope of audit which is given by the bank to the concurrent or the internal auditors or their internal team. If it is a part of the scope, then the duty of the branch statutory auditor is to ensure whether this has been covered by them and commented effectively. If this has not been covered by them, then no way that we could find it out. If we can find it out in the short period of time, then we may make some comments. Otherwise, we clearly have to give a disclaimer that this was never ever covered under the scope of audit. And there has been no action taken by the bank in this regard. Now, what is the role of a concurrent internal auditor post demonetization? So, if you may not be a branch statutory auditor, but you clearly are still the concurrent auditor, you still have to issue the report for the month of February and for the month of March. The immediate role in checking is how cash deposited in various accounts were finally reversed, whether there is any technical support in analyzing the data. Now, this clearly is once the money has come in, when you look into AMI transaction clearly talks of three stages which I said. One is the placement where the cash has been placed. Then it talks of bearing. So once the cash has been placed, let's say I have 10 lakh rupees with me. I would have deposited in 5 accounts 2 lakhs each. Then after that 2 lakhs, I would have collected it and got each one of them to deposit into my account. So that would be the layering stage. First is the placement stage, the second is the layering stage, where that 10 lakhs and then that 10 lakhs are issued for purchase of shares and something and created an asset. That's the indication. The AML process given by RBI clearly talks of these three steps, and this is how even in the demonetization process, most of these cash which has been coming to various sources through a family account, you'll have an 80-year-old mother who has never ever come to the bank, who doesn't even know what a bank is, who may be using actually a thumb to actually sign, would have 2,49,999 rupees deposited in that account. Now, technically, that would clearly be suspicious because as a 95-year-old, then I would only justify that this was a savings over the period. But whether the transaction is suspicious or not, but yes, 2,49,999 deposited in that account, then I have some other employees or either I have deposited various cash, and finally, I have transferred it to one main account. And from that, I use it to do anything. Now, that's classical money laundering stages of placement, layering, and integration is what I need to seriously look at. Ensure adverse issues noted are effectively addressed. I think some issues just can't be addressed. If they don't have a recording facility, they will never do it. If they did have a UV lamp, how can they address it? If they allow exchange to multiple customers, it's a valid issue. So you can't rectify certain issues. You only have to report it.
I think there's no change in both compliance with scope of audit as per his engagement letter or checklist continues.
Now, there is the duty of a concurrent auditor, because concurrent audit basically came into place because of the Harshad Mehta scam which happened in 1992, it basically has an early warning signal to prevent fraud and serious irregularities. So if the cash deposited during demonetization is used for money laundering, then I think concurrent auditor has a very serious role to play. It's the duty of the internal auditor to be vigilant that risks are identified on an ongoing basis and steps are being taken to mitigate the risk to an acceptable level. That's the role of an internal auditor. So the branch internal audit team who says they have that role, very clearly. Whether they are doing that role or not, if that's not done, maybe you could comment it's not in time. Now, I've come specifically to the role as a branch statutory auditor. Comment in the LPR and any other standards to be reported to whether the branch is going to be guidelines of the standards.
Volume, please.
Comply with those guidelines. Whether there is any adverse reporting by the branch internal to a concurrent auditor. Branch responses to these adverse findings. And there's specific comments as per guidance from the audit of banks 2017 edition that standards code has not been printed as a hard copy, but it's available in the institute website. So I think you can have a look. I think I have already discussed those 4 points. The role of a central statutory auditor is that the branch is ensured compliance with RBI circular strict and better audit process to ensure compliance. There is a process adequacy. At the central statutory audit level, we'll have to incorporate adverse comments of the branch and how the branches have addressed those issues. And whether any material violation noted at specific individual branches or in accumulation at the bank. These are extreme limits just for academic interest. I think I've taken the trouble to actually do it with various circulars, so maybe you could just vote and we could use. These were the extreme limits. These were the limits on ATM withdrawals. These were the limits on savings banks and current account withdrawals. The median rate of this earlier it was 10,000, then 20,000, then 24,000, then 50,000, then some. Some circulars which was on 19 December to 21st December that you could only take cash not more than 5,000. If you have taken cash more than 5,000, then it has to be with two people, two officials, or with some explanations. So such specific instances you have to check. So if there was a marriage, then they wanted the marriage wedding card. They wanted other proofs. Then they wanted a declaration that the person whom you are paying money doesn't have a bank account. And because you doesn't have a bank account, you need to pay cash. I think what a lot of banks still have done is somebody has a marriage, somebody has printed a marriage card, they have given it to an outlet. They have not ensured that those other 3 points which RBI mentioned in circulars were taken care of. So technically there is a violation of those circulars. Now, concurrent auditors are supposed to find that out. If they have not found out that out, but if let's say you see, if you ask in your checklist whether there is any withdrawals for marriage purposes, and if he says yes, then you may check for the record. If you don't find, then maybe even if the concurrent auditor has missed out, you might find any point. You might put it. I think banks would seriously have missed the point on few occasions. Because they would not find it maybe as within the limited resources or as per communication to actually comply with all these points. So you will have issues on exchange of goods. You will have issues on dispensation of cash because cash was just not available. Limits on withdrawals, maybe if they were, how they were monitoring, maybe they could have been breached if it's not an automated environment. Obtaining PAN. Now, whether PAN which was furnished was the genuine PAN. Now, that would be another case how the bank is ensuring that the PAN was not genuine because somebody would have forged the PAN. So, whether they have done any checks with, if it's not a individual customer, especially for third party customers where they had done exchange of cash, who had furnished PAN, whether the PAN was genuine or not, I don't think they would have taken any steps, especially the small cooperative bank. Reporting mechanism, submission of information, they had to do a lot of reporting, whether they had done it timely, whether it was accurate, what was the source on which this data was compiled. Then special provisions for farmers, managers, NRI, NR account, the Prime Minister, Jandan Yojana, Jandan accounts. CCTV recording the footage storage. You have grace period for NPA classification, interest subvention, as I said, other than we take care of it, and other administrative processes and arrangement for cash in transit, custody of cash, effective joint custody of cash. So, talks of, we discussed that initial consideration, risk assessment and internal control. So I had now the circular I talked about the 21st November and then one more circular on December 28th. And then the key point where I said that he has to talk on the balances, retention limits, the transit of cash and the insurance coverage and the effective joint custody of cash. So this is where the LFR and Sanchez he has to specifically comment on demonetization issues, particularly non-compliance of RBI directives, report on recomputation of retention limits as per bank policy for FPA, coverage of NPN during SSP during transit, compromise on effective joint custody of cash, conversion of inoperative accounts to operative accounts. I think that would be one serious area which one needs to look into, whether, so this is a fraud prone area. LFR of banks at the central exchange of ATMs deposit deficit general permit, daily weekly withdrawal limits to ATM how these were supplied, transfers of SBI to RBI, issuance of new notes, and filing of CPR, SPR and various reports to RBI. I think the purpose is auditors to report on misuse of the process taken down by RBI. I think it's correct whether why the circulars were issued, whether there was no misuse of this process, and whether there was no affecting of any money laundering activity. I think the key would be the SPR which would have been filed, the operation of dormant account. And I think how effectively bank has leveraged technology to actually find analytics on how cash was deposited prior and now. And as we talk of the AML process, the placement has been done. And in post demonetization process, the actual layering and integration will happen. And maybe that would have happened also today. So maybe I don't know whether this was a blessing or maybe they had its drawbacks. I don't want to comment on that, but I'll just agree on that. I just make, if there is a cash shortage over a specified amount, that is considered, let me come to it, I wondered, but if there is a cash shortage over a specified amount, that is considered a fraud. So RBI has given a very clear limit of 5,000 or 10,000. If your cash shortage is more than that, my first question is that it has to be reported as a fraud, one, if it's not reported. The second, if the account of the customer has been debited, but the customer is disputing that, and maybe the customer has maybe filed a case or a complaint or whatever it is, I think it will be prudent to make a provision for that amount. Or if the bank is not making a provision, you can insist on passing an MOC if the amount is material over that amount for an MOC with a threshold which is given. If it's within the threshold, you are all the way within your means to report it to the central statutory auditor and any other matter. But I would first like to take exception on the process of the bank for detection of a note as a fake note. I think the detection of a note as a fake note has to be detected at the time of receipt. Now from your issue, it appears that this was detected subsequently. So that is one of the biggest process failures at the branch which you should highlight. If it was known there and there itself, I think it was clearly a case where then they should have followed the RBI circular on counterfeit notes, but it clearly says that the notes have to be impounded and a FIR has to be filed with the police. I think that also would not have been done. Now, how would the bank know? And the customer can rightly dispute in such a case. Now, I am just taking a legal view. If I was there in his place, I will say this is not my note. How are you very sure that this is my note? It could belong to all customers who had deposited cash on that day. So how can you be so sure? So if you are talking legally, I think the bank is on a slightly weaker wicket. Clearly there is a gap in the procedure where the fake note should have been detected at the time of issue. So I think all these points you can make a mention in your LHR, and I would suggest that you provide.
Machines are not ready to verify whether it's fake or it's a genuine.
See, one, the auditor is not an expert in detecting whether the note is fake or not. The auditor is only an instrument to make the management aware whether risks are being identified and risks are being controlled and mitigated. So one of the risks which is identified by the auditor is the possibility that a fake note could be collected in the 2000 rupee new notes which have been issued. The control is that the bank would have maybe UV lamps or fake detection note machines which will have the capacity to detect whether these notes are fake or not. Now if bank doesn't have a control, I think you should highlight it in your LFR, in any other matters which you want to give as a highlight of the management, that the bank currently doesn't have any control mechanism to find out whether the 2000 rupee notes which are being deposited by customers are fake or not, as the current fake note detection machines in deployment are unable to identify whether a 2000 rupee note is fake or not. I think that should be enough, because you clearly highlighted the weakness in control. See, I'm again talking demonetization was a risk. Demonetization was a risk which was never anticipated. So none of them were prepared, either RBI or the banks. So that's why you had issues in implementation. These issues, these regulatory changes are bound to happen. So suddenly you need that this was demonetization one, the second demonetization two will also come on some impact. What this was today's article, I think in Financial Chronicle or something, where the demonetization two will come with even harsher impact on real estate and gold. And at that point of time, there were clearly some rumors floating that you can't open your lockers, or if your lockers would be monitored, or you can't still there's no clarity on how much gold one can hold. So 250 grams or 250, 500 grams collectively. I don't know, there was one clear issue where I had where I still, this is a private public, private gathering. I think RBI or the government, when it made an announcement, it clearly said that these notes would be accepted till 30th December at all designated bank branches, and post that it would be accepted at RBI till 31st March. I think that was what I had clearly heard on the time of announcement. I think post 30th December, from 1st March, RBI is clearly not accepting those notes. So I think it was a clearly, it went back on its original words. The second was the circular which were issued from 19 December that you cannot now deposit more than 5,000 rupees at one go. And some circulars to stop this, they had used something like those indelible ink and something. I think this was clearly a way that this process was not managed properly. I think maybe they were not prepared. So as I said, it's an unanticipated black swan risk event which nobody was prepared for. So you had to face those initial teething problems. And that 21st where you had two officials who would try and see whether it was genuine, and suddenly that circular was withdrawn from 21st. But that circular still applied on those two dates. So even if the circular was withdrawn subsequently, if the technical interpretation of that circular is somebody has accepted more than 5,000 rupees on 19th and 20th of December without complying with whatever conditions were applicable on two days, is clearly in default. I don't think so. Circular will apply from the date of issuance of the circular. If they have not received it, then that is their problem. That's what I said. I think one of the biggest problems of, let's say, this is not only on demonetization. When you are talking about any circular which is issued by the bank, internal circular, if the circulars are not available at the branch, how will you know what circulars you have to verify? So your LFR clearly states as per the instruction issued by controlling authority. Now if you don't have a clear tab on what are the total instructions issued, how will you comment? So I think one, either you give a disclaimer at the start of the LFR, which I generally give, that the LFR is given based on the work done by me on so and so dates. So though I am commenting on the LFR for the entire year, I was not there in the branch for more than 350 days of the year. It is a fact. And second is, unless the bank is on intranet, all the circulars are on intranet and you have access to those intranet and you can pull down all the circulars, I think you would just not know whether this circular which you have shown off some December 2016 is overridden by a bank circular or not. So that issue will always remain, so I think give suitable disclaimer. Or default for specific circular based on this circular, which was the only latest available circular issued to me or given to me by the bank, I report as under. So, your issue one, that the branch was not aware of that circular will not stand. I think ignorance of law is no excuse. One is the circular I would state as a law binding, and non-awareness of that is not an excuse.
Now it is the time for layering and integration. So, while auditing, we should keep our all senses awake and then we should look for that. As stated, we have already spilled into Dhananjay sir's time. I would now propose a formal vote of thanks to Abhijit ji. A big round of applause for taking this time out. Thank you. Thank you so much.